Hello and welcome to the very first DCU TV news broadcast of the year. My name is Claire Prenti. There was a big announcement made in DCU this week and our Jack Butterley was there to find out what happened.
Today in the Helix saw the launch of the campaign for DCU taking place, with Bremercry announcing over €343 million in investment in the college in the near future to secure the future of DCU in upcoming years. Along with this is over €200 million in investment to be detailed later on in the next coming academic year. But the main focus of today was a €100 million campaign to raise funds to support over the 21 different projects taking place that will shape the future of both journalism, water conservation, sport and student life in DCU in the upcoming years, facing both issues on campus and across the world.
This campaign, this €100 million campaign, is about 21 projects covering the areas of research and innovation, teaching and learning, student development and human capital.
These 21 projects include UStart, a new student centre, Learning Future Labs, the GAA National Education and Research Centre and the Future Media and Journalism Centre. Breen McCrae was also joined on stage by Larry Quinn, chairperson of the DCU Educational Trust, futurist Dr. Peter Cochran, who spoke about the importance of the need for new economic models adapting to new technologies.
If we continue to make decisions on the basis of a single parameter, money, we are going to destroy the entire planet.
Followed by a panel discussion which include Head of the Student Support and Development Office Claire Bohan, President of St Patrick's Campus Dr Dara Keogh and SU President Kim Sweeney. Afterwards we caught up with Breen McCrae to ask him a few questions.
So Breen, tell us, in regards to the €100 million campaign fundraising, is the €100 million being pumped into exclusively the 21 projects being mentioned today, or is this money already been raised to support these projects?
No, I mean, the €100 million figure comes from looking at the 21 projects and estimating the value of each of those, and that's where the number comes from. But we expect, as we fund certain projects, we'll add in more, so that number could increase even further. But I suppose we wanted to be realistic but ambitious, that sort of combination. And having raised €25 million already in the so-called quiet phase, it has given us all confidence that we can actually get to the €100 million. It won't happen next year or the year after. This is extended over a period of time. And campaigns typically last 7 to 10 years.
So you mentioned there that there was also over to €200 million in infrastructure that is planned to be announced throughout this year and next year. I was just wondering in regards to, has that money already been raised, or is that also another separate campaign to be launched in the near future?
It's not a campaign, this will be investment, and you'll be hearing in great detail either late November or early December. All of that we'll be talking in absolute detail around this, and it's not fundraising per se, it's investment. And I'm not allowed to say any more than that there, but it's real and you'll hear all the details, and you'll hear it first on DCU FM and DCU TV, okay?
I'm Jack Butterley, DCU TV News.
The Executive Director of Amnesty Ireland, Colm O'Gorman, visited DCU last week to give a talk. Megan Rowntree went along to hear what he had to say.
Amnesty International's Colm O'Gorman paid a visit to DCU this week to talk about his work with Amnesty Ireland and more specifically the Syrian crisis. O'Gorman discussed Europe's position in the crisis and gave details of a visit he recently paid to Lebanon to express how dire the situation really is.
So I was in Lebanon a couple of weeks ago, visiting some of the informal tented settlements there, the settlements where Syrian refugees in Lebanon are living. And it was deeply disturbing and extraordinarily revealing and horribly fascinating to see the situation there. And even though I knew it, it's when you see it firsthand you begin to understand the pressures that people are on. We're in the midst of a global refugee crisis. There are about 60 million displaced people in the world today. And just under 20 million of those are formally recognised as refugees. So we have the largest refugee crisis since the Second World War. And it's a completely predictable crisis. We've seen it grow over the last 5 years or more.
O'Gorman also discussed other human rights issues, such as female genital mutilation, and a proposal to reappeal the Eighth Amendment.
So we are a country that have been brutalised by a conversation about abortion, and that means that we don't say the word, we don't have the conversation. It's really changing. There are women now who are coming out and talking about their experience. Tara Flynn, the comedian, Roisin Ingle, the Irish Times journalist who's spoken about it recently. We've been working with them, and they've been coming out and telling their stories.
The event was organised by the International Relations Society. I spoke to chairperson Joseph Dillon about organising the event.
Well, Colm is probably one of Ireland's most capable and active human rights defenders and activists. I mean, he was obviously really, really famous with the marriage equality campaign. He made a big name for himself, but, you know, prior to that, he was already a well-established human rights worker in Ireland. But I thought, you know, people in DC would have been really interested in that, because obviously the marriage equality campaign was a big thing for young people, and Colm O'Gorman was, you know, I just thought he would really appeal to people. But what he did personally, I mean, he was going to Lebanon and he was actually looking at what they were doing on the ground and the situation that's there. And I think what's most interesting about Colm is that he's able to humanise.
I'm Megan Rowntree, DCU TV News.
The Enactus World Cup took place in Johannesburg last week and several DCU students travelled all the way to South Africa to attend the event. Here's Aoife McCormack to tell us more.
Enactus is DCU's social entrepreneurial society. They come up with a series of social projects during the year in the hope of representing Ireland in the Enactus World Cup. This year, the competition was held in Johannesburg. I caught up with Vice Chair of Enactus DCU, Alison Ring, to find out more about the competition and what Johannesburg was like.
Basically like the World Cup of Student Social Enterprise. So there's 36 countries and each country has a university that represents them. And the universities, the teams are all judged on their social projects. So basically, whichever country has come up with the best social business, they win. So Maynooth University represented Ireland this year. They didn't get through the first round. The overall winners were actually the UK, the University of Southampton. They had four projects based in one African community, so that's probably why they won. Their impact was huge and they were totally sustainable. They weren't dependent on grants or anything, so they had really, really brilliant projects. Johannesburg as a city is, there's huge contrast between wealth and poor. The inner city is quite poor. It's a really colourful place, a lot of like character to it, but quite dangerous. And where we were staying was the more business district, upper class kind of, and we were sheltered from a lot of it, but and a lovely city, definitely go visit it. We had a great time all together.
I'm Aoife McCormack for DCU TV News.
Last Monday to Thursday, DCU's SU ran their annual Shag Week on campus. I went along to some of the events and here's how I got on.
DCU's annual Shag Week took place last week on campus. I caught up with Welfare Officer Donal Harkin, who told me some more about Shag Week.
So Shag Week is Sexual Health Awareness and Guidance Week, so educating students on their sexual health and other issues around consent. We had a sex doctor who educated students on STIs, we had a sex anthropologist who came in and spoke about consent, and we had free STI checks as well. So the whole week about educating students and making them more aware of all issues related to sex.
Many societies were on board to help out with Shag Week, including MPS, who set up the Shag Pad in the hub. The Rag Society also did their share by handing out condoms to students. And the week's most popular event, Dance Society's Full Monty, which saw some of DCU's most popular clubs and societies bearing all in the name of charity. This is Claire Prenti for DCU TV News.
The Snow Sports Society held a balloon drop in the hub last week. The event was a huge success. Our Rebecca was there on the day to capture it.
I'm here outside the hub in DCU where we just saw the DCU Snow Sports Balloon Drop. This is an annual event where great prizes are given out to some lucky winners. We took a look at the action.
Memories turn to dust. Please don't bury us. I got you.
Today.
It was the annual balloon drop, so it's basically when we get like, we kind of get around 1,000 to 1,500 balloons, we just stuff them in the net, put a lot of prizes, the main one being the little food trip, whatever. It was dropping, everyone wants to fight for prizes.
That's it for me, I've been Rebecca Lowy from DCU TV News.
After the huge success of the Harry Potter films, the Harry Potter Society started in DCU in 2012. Since then, the society has grown from strength to strength. Here's an insight into what they do.
This week, we
caught up with the Harry Potter Society to discuss exactly how the society works, as well as talking about the upcoming Triwizard Tournament.
I'm Rachel from the DCU Harry Potter Society. So I understand you're preparing for the Triwizard Tournament. Can you tell me a bit about that?
Right, well, so this week we're getting everyone to sign up. So we were actually in Pats today for an hour on their lunch break, and we were here as well in the hub signing up yesterday. And then tomorrow on Thursday, Thursday we're doing a quiz in Old Bar, and we're going to have the cup there, and everyone can sign up on the spot. Decided to enter the Triwizard Tournament. What do you think you've done to prepare yourself for this?
Well, from a very young age, I always enjoyed sweeping the floors with my brooms, and I do plenty of broom push-ups every day. It's quite fantastic. I also tend to go on the Harry Wiki and look up every spell. Like, I've practiced the wording, you know, Expecto Patronum! And
when's it, February?
February 20th.
We have a Yule Ball as well, so that'd be... Like, when else you get to say, ooh, I went to a Yule Ball, so...
Very interesting, yeah. And is there much competition between the universities?
In our houses, yeah. In DCU, like, in between Slytherin, Ravenclaw, Hufflepuff and Gryffindor, there's definitely tension. Like, there's already subcommittees set up, and Gryffindor and Slytherin are gonna, like, it's gonna be bitter.
And is there equal respect for the book lovers and the movie lovers? Is there a bit of rivalry there as well?
No, it's not
a problem. It's, you know, everyone's just there to have fun. We're not gonna discriminate just because some people haven't read the book.
So there you have it. Hopefully we can bring the cup back to DCU this year, and best of luck to all those involved. This is Liam Ashton for DCU TV.
That's all the news for now. We'll be back in a fortnight.